Hello, folks. It's Alan here. I'm just in the pre-show right now. I sent a message to my guest. I'm now hopefully going to have, just bear with me a couple seconds. If you're coming on at a later time to watch the recorded version, what you want to do is just look to the top of the screen there in the little blurb that I put out, and you'll see the time when the actual video starts. I've got to go through this whole process in order to get things up and live on my website. So that's what I'm doing right now. It takes a minute or two for me to get this all set up and my guests to arrive, but bear with me. This will happen fairly quickly now that I've got everything almost set up here. I'm going to go insert into post, and now I'm updating the website. So now I'm going to go to my website and make sure that we are live on the website, which I believe we now are. And I'm still, the only thing I'm awaiting now is to see that John, my guest, has arrived. I haven't seen him yet, but it's just the old interwebs doing their thing. Yep, we're live on the website now. Perfect. So now, just got to wait for John to get here and we'll be ready to roll. We have a lot to talk about. Again, if you're watching this part of the show now, I've just set everything up to be live on my website for a 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time start to the show. But sometimes it takes a minute or two to get everything live on the site and everything. So what you do is, if you're coming in for the recorded version later, just look above me there on my website, and I'll put the time that the actual show starts. I've sent that email over to my... Oh, here he is calling me. Hey, John?
Yeah, where are you sending something to? Are you doing it to the Google Hangout?
No, I'm doing it to your Gmail account, or to your email. I just sent you an email with the invite to the place where you click, and it'll take you here.
Okay, yeah, all right then.
You got it on your email?
Well, no, the email's on the other computer, so I got to go and find it.
Okay.
It's a bit of coffee. I'm at a different workstation. I don't have all that stuff.
Oh, do you want me to? I can send it to another email if you want, John.
Send it to my Gmail account.
Okay, let me just make...
PDAC research@gmail.com.
Hold on. Let me just make sure I've got it to the right one. I think it'll automatically go to your John. Yeah, it's a J. Kaiser at research. Okay, what is it, John?
The one. canspec@gmail.com.
research@gmail.com. Perfect. You'll have it in a moment, John. Just follow that link. Okay?
All right.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye. So I sent it to the wrong email, everybody. You probably heard that on the phone call. That's why we get the pre-production a little bit earlier. We've got it all straightened out now. John will have that invite in his correct email any second now, and we'll get the show started. As I was sort of introing there, John was just at the PDAC in Toronto, the big miner and prospectors and developers association annual conference. And John is always one of the keynote speakers at the conference. He did a presentation at the PDAC investor forum. And then he also was on the BNN television show on Tuesday. And he did a great, he did a market call on BNN, and what you do in the market call. I've done these before, is people call in with random companies, and you sort of have to go solely on your memory. And I know it can be a little bit challenging, and I want to talk to John about that experience. I thought he did a great job, but he should have lots to talk to us about. So there he is, the man, John Kaiser.
Alan,
how you doing, man?
So I got to figure out what I'm looking at here. Is that better?
Yeah, you're fine, man. Everything looks great to me.
And I got my own PowerPoint here on the left.
Perfect. So we're ready to go, John. I've just been doing the pre-show sort of taping, so I'm going to get on to the regular show now.
One thing, I'm still confused. When I'm talking, people can't see the PowerPoint, right?
Unless you screen share it, but the problem is, John, when the guest screen shared on Google Hangouts, it has some quirky glitch that if you use the screen share, it seems to become a problem switching back and forth between the screens. But if I have the screen share on my end, then when I'm asking you a question, that screen share page will come up. It's much easier to do it that way, John.
Okay, but when I talk, it disappears, and all you have is my mug.
Your handsome face, yeah.
So that's a problem, because I can't talk to the slide. So what I'm also going to do is tell people at the beginning to go to kaiserresearch.com, download the PDF, and then you'll say, okay, let's move on to slide one or two.
Yep.
Well, whatever, and then people can follow it while they're listening to me blather on.
Perfect, John. We got it all under control, man.
Okay.
I've got it ready, John. So I'm going to get started here. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. I've got another special guest on the show. John Kaiser from Kaiser Research Online is back in his home office from the PDAC conference in Toronto. John, thanks for joining us again.
Alan, thanks for giving me a chance to do a proper presentation, not jammed into 24 minutes like I had to do at the PDAC, and record it so everybody at their leisure can go and see what on earth I was telling those people in that small room there in Toronto.
Was anybody actually recording it?
I do not believe the newsletter presentations get recorded.
Well, then we've got a real special show today, because John's going to go over, we're going to go over in depth his talk from the conference, and I'm really pumped about it. John, I want to tell you that I just skimmed through the presentation, mainly because when I'm doing these, I'm learning about what you're talking about at the same time. And so I didn't want to become too prepared, but I did see some really top-notch stuff in there. I heard the room was pretty full for your talk at the PDAC.
Yeah, and the way we're going to do this, it's very different. Like when I normally stand up there, I download whatever it is that comes into my head as I look at my own slides to the audience. But what we're going to do is I'm going to talk about my slide, and then you're actually going to be like the audience asking me about stuff, and we can do interactive, and then when we've beaten it to death, we can move on to the next slide. And so this is going to be very different. It's going to be all over the map. And I recommend that anybody who has pulled up this video, go to my site, kaiserresearch.com, find the little conference speeches section, download the PDF, open it, go to page one, and follow this, because when I'm talking, unfortunately, you won't be able to see the slide, but if you've got your slideshow up on your computer, and we will mention what slide number we are on as we move through this presentation.
So I got a good idea, John. We'll do a little bit of preamble to get people the chance to go to your website, the ones that are live, and to get that. And then when people are coming to watch the recorded version, they could just pause right now and run to your website, grab that PDF, and follow along. But before we go into that, I wanted to, as always, you know my tradition here, I talk about my sponsors. I've got two sponsors. One is Premier Gold Mines. Premier Gold Mines, PG on the Toronto Exchange, has a great group of projects Various different phases, from exploration in Red Lake for high-grade gold all the way to production. They've got partnerships with Barrick Gold. They're a great company to check out. Wolfden Resources is another company of mine. They're a smaller company, exploration company. They're a sponsor. They have a high-grade discovery of nickel and copper in just outside of Manitoba. Both those companies were recently at the conference. I know you follow them a little bit, John. Did you have a chance to pop by either of them or have any further look into either of them since I last talked to you?
Well, one of the frustrating things about this conference was I spent very little time on the investor exchange floor, and Wolfden was definitely on my list to track down. So it's going to have to be done by phone. This conference, it goes by so fast. Starts on Sunday, and next thing you know, I'm checking out of the hotel. It was super fast this year, and it's changed in a way too. It's not quite like it used to be, where you had so much serendipity opportunities. There was so much mingling. Now you needed to have secret invites to go to this little hospitality suite and this night and whatever. And for some reason, I didn't get any of those. So that shows you how far we sunk into this bear market. And on, you know, the Fairmont Royal York, they used to have the floors 5 and 6, all those hospitality suites. The lawyers got into it a few years back and became concerned about all the drunks and everybody just drinking way too much, especially geology students and so on, who would all come to this. And so they started being concerned about when these people wander off absolutely hammered and get themselves into trouble, it's going to come back, oh yeah, they were in the tech booth or in the tech hospitality suite and they plied them with liquor, and so we're going to sue them. So everything has become much more tame and dull than it used to be. So it's that random encounter is just not there anymore.
Plus the market has really tempered things quite dramatically over the last 4 or 5 years. But, you know, one of the things that I always noticed over the years, John, is there's a lot of newsletter writers out there that generally don't spend a lot of time on the floors of these things. And you were one that I would always bump into on the floor because I do really enjoy those serendipity opportunities. But I'll tell you, this year I stayed here and I was doing some reporting. I uncovered a new company. I was able to watch your BNN interview. I probably wouldn't have done that in the past. I think you did a great job with that market call segment, John. How did you like that random rapid fire? I've done it once or twice on BNN before. What did you think of it?
Well, I was pretty nervous going into it because I'm familiar with these companies, but when I'm not focused on them, the details are just not in my head. Now we do cheat a bit. They do ask me, will you take this question? And if it's some company that I really know nothing about or have nothing but bad things to say about, I say, well, let's find something else which I know something about or have something positive to say. But I do make exceptions, though.
I was wishing you would have let it come through, John. When you are hammering something, it's one of the funniest things. I do enjoy when you're hammering a company. You should have let one or two of those through.
Well, I mean, I did in an indirect way.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure how many people got it, and we'll leave it at that. Don't want to make too many people unnecessarily mad at me.
Before we go on to the presentation, John, why don't we talk for a couple minutes? The last time you were on, you know, I always tell people I'm an old country reporter, and this is how I keep my notes and everything, John. I still have a little notebook, and but I did keep track of the companies we talked about. And what really struck me the last time you were on is you talked about Arizona, AZ, you talked about Sirius, you talked about East Main, and and UVN. And within days, all of those companies had big news. And Arizona's AZ has been on a real nice run since you sort of gave me a scoop on that the last time you talked, John. Can you give us a little update on those ones and what your thinking is now?
Well, it's On Friday, last Friday, I moved Arizona Mining Inc. from a simple bottom fisher buy recommendation in the 30 to 49 cent range to a formal spec value hunter buy at 46 cents. So now my broader audience that doesn't pay the $800 a year gets to see all my commentary on it. And now it's like a major pick. It's one, and I do think this one is going to be a $5 plus win in about 2-3 years. The zinc area is the one of the few areas where the commodity specialists are optimistic on. They've also done some housekeeping. The 20% that Richard Wark owned through the holding company, he's now selling it to the company for 40 million shares, so they have 100% of the asset. And they closed off $2.8 million financing at 42 cents, and they started drilling. And they're doing a kind of condemnation drilling. They're literally stepping out into the new claim where it gets deeper because they want to figure out where to put a shaft and all that. And they don't want to put a shaft right into the middle of the best part of the ore body. So I think they got 40 million tons out. I think it'll easily grow to 50 million tons. It's 4.5% lead, 4.5% zinc, and 2 ounce per ton silver. I think they'll get it over 10% plus. This is world class. It's the best thing since Red Dog. It has a valuation of about 108 million now. But in my fair speculation model, the valuation should be from like 57 cents to about $1.44 while they're in this stage of infill drilling and preparing for a PEA, which they think they'll have at the end of this year.
You know, John, I don't know if everybody out there understands the elegance and the value of your rational speculation model. I think I have good insights into it because I remember when you were first starting it out with diamonds and we had tons of talks back then about it. And why I say it's very elegant is that John, and I'm probably going to screw it up a little bit, John, but here's my basic understanding. John's able to graphically represent on a chart how things run generally in a cycle from discovery to production, and where they are, and he then plots where the company is on that cycle and what a fair value is in relation to where they are in the cycle. Did I get it right, John? I think I did.
Yeah, you've got it pretty good, and we're almost jumping ahead of like slide number 24 or whatever, where I do it for Arizona Mining. I mean, that's one of the cool things. I use this system now to visualize the outcome and then discount it back to the stage of uncertainty where the project is right now, and that is a fair speculative value. And if the market's pricing below that, well, then you've got like a mispriced bet and you jump on it. If it's a little higher, well, then you kind of avoid it. But of course, everybody argues about what should the outcome look like. And I've developed all the tools to do this internally. And I'm also working on building something where everybody else out there is going to be a person like me, will log on as their own little registered pseudonym, put in the numbers they think are appropriate, push a button, and they'll get their own outcome visualization with a fair spec value range. And then they'll have a choice of sharing it with everybody else. But we should get into that later if we have another session down the road where we do this more.
Yeah, and I don't want to jump too far ahead there, John, but remind me when we talk about this, but for me, it's much easier to visualize than trying to assess something based on NPV of a project and all that. It just, to me, this is much more elegant. So I'm glad that our viewers are going to get a better look at that when we get down the road. Was there any of these other ones? That Arizona Star is really exciting to me, John. Is there any other of these other ones, Sirius or East Main or UEM, that you might want to make a quick comment on, and then we'll get on to that PDAC slides.
Well, Sirius is starting to become really interesting, and pardon the pun, but this play is getting serious. They stepped out to the northwest into the swamp area where they have no geochem, no bedrock, no geophysics, but just a kind of an interesting theory as to why down ice there is this big gold arsenic geochemical anomaly that has not been explained by the work that East Main and Azimuth and Goldcorp did on the Eleanor South. So they went in there and drilled a bunch of holes, and two of them where it should be near the margin of the between the intrusive and the metasediment country rock, they have mineralization. Don't know the grade yet, but it's the same sort of altered stuff that they have about 1.5 kilometers to the southeast where they've been doing all the work. So they have doubled the footprint or the strike of this system. It's probably now a 300-400 million ton blob of low grade, you know, not economic mineralization. But the story here is, where are the high grade zones within this? And they also put out news that this biotite schist that they intersected also had half decent mineralization. Again, not super ore grade, but it's telling the market that that the hydrothermal system that came through here pumped both the intrusive and the metasediments that it intruded. And now some people are thinking, when they start going deeper underneath this tonalite, and apparently it dips to the west, where things get more busted up and the tonalite acted as sort of a cap, they could find some pretty tremendous mineralization. So they had a lot of serious people at their booth on Monday after that news came out in the morning. And while it's not, you know, barn burner type intersections, it's the geological context that has people thinking, the very least, this is probably going to be mill feed for the Eleanor mine, possibly even better. It's just as good as Eleanor, and perhaps it's a Hemlo type situation. And it is kind of interesting that they've drilled now 40, 50 holes and don't yet have the guts of the system, but have all this smoke. And that reminds me of 1981, 82, when Murray Pesum had his Corona promotion going. He was chasing smoke and getting snippets here and there. And it wasn't until the 80th hole that they hit the high grade stuff that eventually blossomed into a 20 million ounce system. And, you know, as I've looked more and more at this thing, the East Main Azimuth Goldcorp property, where work stalled about 5 years ago when they just didn't find any obvious source for the geochem anomaly, they never really drilled beneath or through the tonalite to see what was piling up underneath it. And the geochemical footprint is quite substantial. So that would be like the equivalent of, say, Dick Hughes's Goliath Gold and Golden Scepter having a piece of the Hemlo deposit, and Lack with the Williams that they stole from Murray until they had to give it back later also. So if this explodes as this multi-company sharing of a major gold system that turns out to have high-grade gold, that will really light a fire under this market.
Well, you know, John, I'm looking for that these days, because gold made a big move. I've been commenting it all along the way. I saw the I've been looking for a bottom for a long time, and that early January action gave me an indication that we were going to have a good January. Came out of January, we sort of finished off a nice cup-type formation on the gold price. Then it went sideways for about a month. Now it's popping up again. I think this is for real this time. I think the bear market's over, and we can start looking rationally at realistic projects. I actually just been writing about one in the last few days, John, and a lot of people on CEO.ca are now following it. Actually, Eric Coffin wrote about it as well, a company called West Red Lake Gold, RLG. I took a little flyer on the stock. Are you following that one, John? It's on the west side of Red Lake.
Where does it trade?
Trades on the Canadian exchange.
That's why I haven't heard of it. I'm still not following that because I don't have a proper data feed, so I don't know anything about it. But if you want to start talking about the market cycle, let's go to slide 2 of the presentation, where we talk about the PDAC curse and whether or not this niceness that we've experienced up till now is going to evaporate on us, or if in fact this year is going to be a violation of the PDAC curse.
Okay, John, well, we're rocking and rolling. We're ready to go on to the slides. I'm going to get a screen share going here in a second, and I think by now any live people could have got to the screen share, so, or to the to your thing there. So I now have it on my screen, John, and the first slide is, there will never be a better bottom fish edition. Holy smokes! let's get rolling.
That's right. There's never going to be a better one, because in a year, we're either totally dead or we have come out of this bear market into probably a 2 to 4 year up cycle. That's, I think, going to be exploration driven, hopefully with a substantial gold component. And this negative type of convergence of factors in the last 5 years, it's never going to make available so much talent, so many companies, so many interesting projects at such cheap prices. That's the reason I changed my company's name from Kaiser Bottom Fishing Report to Kaiser Research Online, because when you get into a bull market, there are no bottom fish, and I become irrelevant. What I didn't realize was that by doing so, I would turn the entire sector into a bottom fish surrounded by a lot of dead fish.
Well, on that note, I think you opened with a flare there, John. I want to move to the next slide. You wanted to talk about slide two, so I am now on slide two. The PDAC curse was broken in 2003, 06, 09. What about 16? I see this chart, John. Let us know what's going to happen.
Okay, first to explain this chart, the blue is the volume on the TSX Venture, of which 3/4 of the companies are resource sector. And the yellow is the 30-day average traded share price. So I take what's trading and I track its average price. And what you can see is those little circles I've parked on top of roughly the end of the first quarter, which is when PDAC takes place in March, usually first two weeks of March. And I've noticed that in almost every year, everything starts sagging. You know, we spend the first quarter, get the big January rally. The PDAC is the big celebration of the sector. Everybody parties, congratulates themselves, looks forward to the trend continuing. And then all these people who had learned about sell in May and go away, they've been doing it sell in March and go away, and everything goes into the garbage can right after PDAC, and the rest of the year is generally miserable. But the exceptions were 2003, and that was when the market sensed the awakening of China and its super cycle. And interestingly, the next violation was 2006, and what happened then was that the majors, the producers, realized that China was not this flash in the pan that was going to go away, and they finally stopped forward selling commodities and said, this is big. And their PowerPoint presentation started having super cycle words and metal density in China compared to the rest of the world and all that stuff. And they started this tremendous raw material mobilization boom, which of course the juniors were a huge part of, because they dragged all these crappy deposits found in previous decades out of the woodwork and started doing feasibility work in the context of these much higher metal prices. And 2009 was a violation, because we actually thought what we suffered in the last 5 years was our destiny after 2008. But two big things happened. China came on with its $600 billion fiscal stimulus infrastructure building program, the sort of Keynesian thing that all these gold bug clowns absolutely loathe, while America was forbidden from doing, and Europe were forbidden from doing Keynesian stimulus, and instead did quantitative easing, monetary money printing. And as you can see, that peaked in 2011, and we've had 5 miserable years. And this year, I think, is something different. Yes, to a large degree, it's driven by gold's rally, a rally that was much better than in 2014 and in 2015, both of which years it failed in the second half of March. This year, the rally is stronger, but we also have a different component. There's a lot more talk about exploration programs aimed at finding something that works with the base and precious metal prices that we have, that don't need gold to go to the moon to be worth anything. So even if gold does falter this year, I think we will see interest carry on. And we are looking for that big new discovery where people say, wow, how big is it? Here's money. Go drill it. Show me where the zone goes. See if the grade gets better. Show us how big it is. And that was the character of the 80s and 90s. That's what Hemlo was about. That's what SK Creek was about. That's what the Lac de Gras, Voisey's Bay, and even our fake Briex was all about. This wasn't so much present in the last decade. Yes, we had Fruta del Norte and we had Eleanor, but the last decade was more about taking existing deposits and showing that they now work in the context of higher metal prices.
Hey, John, there's a couple observations that I'm making here on your chart. One is that there was, in the 2003 and 2006, they were not quite, they were pretty aggressive. The one in 2009 was very aggressive. It had also come after a pretty significant correction in the price of gold. But the other thing I'm noticing is that they generally don't have 5 years of horror stories after the curse before they have another good one. So it's been kind of a long period without a positive bounce.
Yeah, and you know, people always think that the trend will continue forever, and even negative trends, unless you hit the cliff and it's an extinction cliff, do not continue forever. And I think metal prices are about as low as they can go, except in the most hideous depression-type contraction, which I'm sure they will do anything they can to prevent. We've been suffering the backside of the super cycle, and we're in the sort of final consolidation phase for the base metals, and gold has had its shellacking already. And again, the thing that's now driving it is no longer this BS about hyperinflation and fiat currency debasement, which makes really no sense, because if the U.S. dollar tanks against all other currencies,
gold ain't going to be worth much either, John.
Yeah, the cost goes way up. But now we have geopolitical uncertainty entering the equation. There's an anxiety where you just want to own gold as an insurance policy. That produces real price gains, and real price gains are what are fantastic for the juniors. And we only need gold to go to like 1500s, 1700s, and the impact on the sector is huge. You know, if it goes to 3,000 and beyond, then it's extraordinary, so long it's not because there's an absolute catastrophe happening where nobody wants to spend a penny on a penny stock.
So let's move on to your next slide there, John. Less than half of TSX Venture Resource Juniors have positive working capital totaling $1.5 billion. While the rest owe $2.5 billion that will never be paid back. John, I meant to ask you a question that's kind of leading into this slide, I believe, was when I was at the TSX Ventures town hall meeting, I tried to pin John McCouch down because, you know, I had kind of a contradictory story there. You had made the case of them not meeting listing requirements, and he was assuring us that they did. And so, you know, where is the reality here, John? And I think this slide might help me with that.
Well, yeah, you can see the figure there. And the red oval, that's the companies that have negative working capital at different degrees. Obviously, the little purple one is the worst. They have. They owe more than $1 million. And that's like 217, I can't quite see it there. 18% are like absolute toast. So these companies, the exchange doesn't want to delist them because some of it's owned to the management and that for salaries and that they probably didn't deserve. But a lot of it is owed to service providers, even possibly people like you who may have had a sponsor who enjoyed 6 months of being on your site but never did pay and owes you a bunch of money for it, and so. They're hoping that there is this kind of secular turn in the sector that we are talking about is perhaps underway now, that will enable these companies to settle all these debts for paper, do some sort of reorganization, get a new story, and get back on the bandwagon. So that's why they haven't torched these, because when you consider, and you know, a big chunk of that money is owed in Vancouver. Like, look at that there. you look, this one isn't the right chart, but I've got another one on my website, which shows that like $900 million is owed by BC headquartered companies, which means Vancouver. So if all of that turns into a big write-off, the ripple effect goes way beyond the TSX's venture exchanges listing fees and so on. But from a practical point of view, these zombie companies, they're not in the running. And this is what made it easy for me to come up with the best ever bottom fishing edition, because I just ignored companies that owed money, maybe because they're dead. Nobody wants to.
Now you're talking, John, about the key strategy, the key thing that investors can take away about all this thing. All this business to me, John, has always been about filtering. And what you're basically saying is you've got a much easier chance to filter out a bunch of junk, and it makes it easier. I know it makes my life a lot easier. I don't have to follow as many companies anymore.
Yeah, and that's where, you know, I'm starting to get a lot of people doing the little $100 for a 30-day kind of, it's like a trial. It doesn't auto-renew. They just want to go in there. They use the search engine. And because we collect all this data and have it available on a search basis, you can just pick companies, like go to the category that's, $1 million or more and just filter for companies and that, and then look at that. So, you know, with my service here, it's so easier to home in on the high probability success companies, that are survivors, and then it becomes a task. Which one of these is going to take off sooner than later?
I would want to amplify the amount of money and time that saves people. I know for myself, I've been playing around with your tool in the background there as a search tool. It's amazing how much time it's saving me now and will save me in the future, John, because say I want to look for a silver project in Mexico that has less than a $10 million market valuation. Boom, I got a list. I don't have to go around looking here, doing a Google search there, finding another piece over here. It's just, I think that tool alone is worth the money that people pay you to be subscribers.
Yeah, and you know, the depressing thing is, because I'm so busy masterminding this whole information system, I don't have the time that subscribers have to go in there and hit it hard and pull out all the super, super companies. I bet there are people out there who can put together a 10, 12 company spec value hunter portfolio that will outperform what I've been able to do. Mm-hmm. And in fact, this thing is, I'm hoping this thing becomes what people end up subscribing to and render my role obsolete, so that I can sit there and just use it and buy stuff that I buy for myself and just make money on and not have to figure out what to say about it and then follow.
John, we always need you in the business as a commentator. You've been doing it for a long time, and machines will never, they'll get rid of a lot of things, but there's a difference between filtering and then knowing how to separate the wheat from the chaff once you've done your filtering. So I think it's a great tool, and I cannot recommend it enough to people.
So shall we move on to slide 4?
We will. Okay, so hold on. I haven't been so good at the updating. Yes, we went through 1, 2, 3, and we are now on 4. The header is, there will never be a better collection of PDAC curse busters. What you got going there, John?
Well, this is like my sort of gift to all those people out there who used to subscribe and those who perhaps didn't for whatever reason. This is about 60 companies, 60% of my 100 bottom fish plus a couple of spec value hunter companies who exhibited at PDAC. So I put together a handout. I had about 300 copies, and I figured I'd have to sit here for a while after my talk. It just vanished. It's like the good old days when I used to drag a box of my annual bottom fish edition, and I'd show up with like 500 of these, and they would just absolutely disappear in a second. The internet didn't exist in those days.
I was one of the guys grabbing them back then.
you may have been. And so, but this had all the booth numbers. So people grabbed these and went to visit these companies to find out, you know, straight from the horse's mouth, what is it? Why are you on Kaiser's bottom fish list and not the 260 other companies? All of these are really interesting companies. It's like a candy store out there, and it's kind of like this is the PDAC filtered down to companies that I like. I've never seen anything like this.
You had a list of how many companies were at the conference and how many were your PDAC in your list in a percentage wise?
I tagged them all, and you can go into the search engine and click on the PDAC exhibitors, and you can see them all. And there were about 303 companies, so this was about 63. So that's about 20%. In Vancouver at Cambridge, it was about 35%. I think I had like 37 companies out of the 110 that were exhibiting at that thing. So I mean, what that tells you is the system has become self-selecting. Companies with decent stories, they feel it is worthwhile to spend the $5,000, $10,000, $12,000 it costs to be at a conference like that, to be there for ones who want to farm in, for potential investors and so on. That the zombie companies aren't at these conferences. Yeah, in a few years, the zombies will probably be back. But this is why, and ironically, you know, PDAC attendance was down to 22,100 or so this year, down from 23,500 last year, and down from 30,000 plus peak in 2011. It's when the crowd disappears, it's a contrarian thing, and that's what bottom fishing is.
I'd be interested to a few years from now, John, to go back on this and look at how it's done over the years. I have a feeling that as we go forward, your percentage of following, the overall number of exhibitors will go up and your percentage will go down. Although I'm very excited because I think that as an industry, investors haven't been very good at allocating capital in the last cycle. I think they're going to be better in this cycle. This is a kind of indicator that, you know, when you're looking at 25-30% of the people or companies at the PDAC make it into your list, I think that's indicative of a better selection process in general.
Yeah, what I now do with these, I used to crank out a new one every year, and that became kind of bad in the bull market because I end up with a 100 crap fish, and people would get mad at me because these things wouldn't go anywhere. Now my plan is this is now going to be a list that's good for a couple years. I'm going to be adding stocks when those get taken out or do something, do the ultimate sin such as a rollback, then they get delisted from the bottom fish list. In 2-3 years, I will not have a bottom fish list. I'll just have my spec value picks because there's a time to bottom fish and then there's a time not to bottom
fish. So you think that this is kind of going to be an epic list here that we're going to be able to look back specifically at the 2016 PDAC Curse Busters list, and there will be a high percentage of the winners of the future in there as well.
Exactly. That's the point about my title of the talk is there will never be a better bottom fish edition. Okay, maybe 10 years from now, but no, not where we are going in the next 12. This is it. This will be a classic.
Okay. Well, we're going to have to give it a name, the 2016 PDAC Curse Busters list or something, and keep looking back on it, John. I'm going to move to the next slide. It's a broken capital market for Canadian juniors. What are we going to do with this one, John?
Well, I just put that in there. I did not talk too much about it because, you know, I can win back about that for way more time. Everybody knows what the problem is, but I kind of reminded everybody that we are still dealing with a very distressed situation for structural reasons. The brokers have got this suitability requirement that really ties their hands in giving advice to investors, especially ones that are 55 or older. They've come up with a new prospectus and exemption that allows them to sell a private placement to a retail investor if that broker deems this investment suitable to the retail investor. But the reality is, from almost any investor's perspective, the only investment that is suitable is one that goes up and that one sells while it's still up. So these things are still, you know, ways to claw back. But the solution is people need to give up on brokers, open their discount brokerage account, take full responsibility for their gambling stuff, subscribe to services such as mine, and use these tools to like find out what the company's saying, see what the treasury looks like, and take full responsibility. The next one is that the price discovery mechanism.
By the way, I'm 100% with you on that, John. Some fights you can win, some fights you can't. The reality is we don't need to win the fight. We need to win those. We need to win some wars, not fights. And if we're investors, I think you gave them a good piece of advice there. So I'm going to move on to the next one. Structural issues are only half the problem. What number is that, John? I think
this is slide six.
Yes.
So I look at the market as basically governed by four core narratives. There's the commodity cycle one, which says that, okay, base metal prices and other raw material prices are going to go up because demand exceeds supply, and you link it to business cycles, to super cycles, and so on. And we had a fantastic super cycle, but we are now at the other side of the super cycle. There is not going to be another super cycle for some time. Hopefully we get a business cycle related rebound over the next couple of years. But what we experienced in the last decade's not coming back anytime soon, at least not soon enough to bail out the juniors.
I think it's worth noting that, John, we are now, maybe we won't have another growth spurt like that, but the reality is we're at a much higher base now. So 3% growth in today's global economy is different than 3% growth of 40 years ago.
Yes, but I think in one of the later charts, you'll see that the mining industry did what it is good at. When it sees a profit margin, it starts digging rocks out of the ground and extracting the ore and selling it. And almost all mine supply, almost all metals increased anywhere from 50% to 100% in the past decade. So it's now building on that base, and most of it's oversupplied at the moment. So it'll be a while where even the incremental gains on top of that base have any big impact.
Okay, so you've got the four charts here.
So let's look at the gold bug chart. Okay. Now, there what you really need to see is you look at like what happened peak to low. How much gold was extracted since the end of 2012 from the GLD ETF. And it was like over 23 million ounces got sucked out until the low late last year. But what's remarkable is that 4.7 million ounces have been accumulated, a 20% expansion since the start of this year. And this is what worries me, because it is possibly institutions, possibly retail and so on, who sense a trend, who are buying ETF gold. This is mopping up the physical gold because of this is the way the ETF works. But we've heard talk that in China and India, where there are the real long-term consumers of gold, the price of gold has been lagging the Western price by $25, $30 per ounce. So that tells me that it is speculative demand, basically chasing a trend that has driven up the price of gold. And we know ETF holders can change their mind dramatically. Now, one thing that's nice is now there's a different bunch of reasons for interest in gold. One is the negative interest rate policy, which hasn't yet kicked in here in North America, but is the reality now in Japan and Europe. And so that has people saying, wow, it was bad enough that I was like making 0.5% on my savings going forward, which means I can't really live off my principal. I have to start chewing up my principal to survive. But now that they're going to tax my principal 0.5, maybe 1% a year, that's enough. I'm going to own gold. Never mind that gold is very volatile. Now, of course, when the volatility is an up direction, that's fantastic. Then I'm a genius for buying gold and instead of leaving it in. But if for whatever reason it stalls, I mean, we know the big evil vampire squid Goldman Sachs is out there with its $900 target, and what Goldman wants, Goldman gets. So if this turns around, all these people may remember that, oh, well, maybe just losing 0.5% on my $1 million savings is not as bad as watching it go down 20% from, say, $1,300 back to $1,050 or so. So watch this, watch the gold ETF activity. The other reason for it to go up is the growing anxiety about global geopolitical stability. And I think we're going to talk a little bit about Trump later on. But I think the world is becoming quite concerned about where on earth everything is headed. And in this type of buying is long-term purchase of physical as the insurance policy that you do not want to cash. And if that trend continues, that delivers a real gold price gain, not one with, you know, hyperinflation or fiat currency decline, where the costs, you know, track it, and then your little gold deposit is no better off at $10,000 gold than it was at $1,200. So watch for that type of anxiety, geopolitical anxiety-based purchasing trend to continue.
Okay. Let's move on to the next one, John. It is commodity cycle and it's super cycle variation. Juniors do not normally respond to commodity cycle booms, but play a very important role when super cycle booms erupt. Unfortunately, they are very irrelevant when the super cycle winds down. Okay, so where are we here, John?
Okay, there's two purposes behind these two graphics. First, what I've done there is stack the value of all the metals produced annually using their, you know, the average metal price. And you can see the few bumps there in 1988 and again in 95, 96, and then just right around the dot-com bubble peak. Those are sort of business cycle-driven commodity boom busts, and the juniors don't really follow those in terms of chasing after copper or nickel because it is up, because the amount that it's up and the expected duration of the upness really isn't enough to get people excited about say a copper project or a nickel project. Discoveries are another matter. You pull a 2% copper intersection and a big target, say a Voisey's Bay, 4% nickel, 3% copper. Who cares what nickel or copper are doing? But the super cycle, you can see that generated interest across the board for metals. And now you can see the decline. It peaked in 2011, and it's probably got a little bit more left to decline at the end of this year. But you're not going to see substantial growth. Like if you look at the acceleration from 2002, from like $200 billion worth of metal.
That kind of a ramp up. Okay, I understand.
That's why the kind of oomph that we got, we're not going to get it. And the other chart, which is important, I draw your attention to the orange line, which is India's GDP as a percent of global GDP and projected global GDP growth. And you look at the US one, which is the blue line, and it's sort of in a long-term relative downtrend. And then the pink one, China, sort of starting to rocket around the 2003-04, which was the awakening. And now you can see it starting to flatten as it's exhausted much of its double-digit growth potential. The problem with India,
India hasn't had that explosive growth yet.
No, it's just that its economy is just 3.3% of GDP, and the IMF's growth projections are quite modest. In 2020, it would be 3.8%, and China was really like about 4.5% when it started to have an impact on raw material stuff. So, 2020 is the earliest that I would think India could start driving super cycle demand and start having explosive GDP growth of the sort that catches the mining industry offsite as happened in between 2003 and 2006. So that's why I say don't count on the super cycle to create a repeat of the last decade.
Okay. I just realized, John, I've been trying to monitor the chat site to see if there was any questions coming in, but we'll go on to the next slide. I think what you're saying there, John, is that we do have a fuel to move for some growth of a super cycle. Probably is not going to be anything like it was back in before, but there's still that potential there, right?
That's right. And you know, the commodity talks on Sunday, they were generally gloomy about seeing meaningful price increases for base metals. That they figure there's still too much stocks in the warehouse that need to be drawn down. There's still too many marginal mines that need to be shut down. There's been a reluctance to shut down the more expensive mines. Now here on slide 8, I've got an old cost curve from copper.
And is this the one I've got up now, John? The greatest likelihood for higher medium term?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Perfect. Go ahead, expound on that one, John. I just wanted everybody to see it for a bit.
So the way the mining industry normally works, you see that sort of big rectangle at the right end, and that little black line is basically the cost of production for that extra piece of amount of metal that's coming out, and the highest cost mines are stacked towards the end. So we can expect that as copper lumbers along here between $2 and $2.50, that production will get shut down, and that will enable the supply demand to come back into balance. And that's the way normal things happen, and it's beginning to happen. And hopefully that will enable copper to eventually be $2.50, $3, and $3.25, or so on. But the new theme that's one of my other narratives, the third narrative, the security of supply narrative, is that lower cost segments of the cost curve could abruptly go offline. Why? Well, suppose Congo, which has pretty low cost copper and cobalt production, suppose they have another insurrection there, such as they did in the mid 90s, and the country goes nuts into a civil war. Well, then their 100,000 tons or whatever it is of copper that they produce suddenly disappears, shuts down. So what I'm predicting is, as this world gets more turbulent, as globalization comes under siege, as the United States gets into a pushing match with China over the South China Sea, its island building activities there, and also with regard to Kim Jong-un and his craziness in North Korea and China's inability to get that under control. So we see Japan and Korea now talking with the United States about building a big defense shield against the crazy North Koreans. And of course, the Chinese are looking at this. Well, that will also work against us, so we don't like that. So we've got all these tensions building. And of course, we have Putin in Russia. He would like to make the Soviet Empire whole again, get all those South Central Asian countries back into the fold, Eastern Europe back in the fold. If these things start pushing, especially if America turns into a clown country with incoherent, crazy people in charge of it, all hell could break loose around the world, and that could result in knock-on effects all over and reduce supply for reasons that have nothing to do with rational cost-cutting and consolidation. And so from the juniors, that could be...
You know, John, I think that's really important to make that point, because... You know, we are looking at a crucially important commodity there in copper, and you want to keep an eye on what happens. And those kind of supply, it's not that liquid, it's not that big of a market that it could really handle any serious supply problems that are unforeseen.
Yeah, and you look at that chart on the right where I give you a pie breakdown of where all the copper comes from, and Chile, okay, well, you might look into, is Chile got some water or power problems maybe coming
along?
That's
what I was going to ask you. That's 31% of the production.
Yes, and Chile, of course, is what made copper a dog in the 80s and 90s, because so much copper came on stream after the Americans wiped out wiped out the I think it was his name, Allende, and put in Pinochet and so on, and it kind of made life really miserable for copper producers elsewhere in the world. But look at Congo, it's like almost 6%, Zambia 4%, Kazakhstan, 2.3% is not much, but it is meaningful. And then there's China itself. Nobody knows about any really, really big, fantastic, world-class Chinese deposit. It comes from all these small deposits that run at all different scales, and you don't know how dirty, polluting they are. You don't know how close they are to getting too deep to mine it without the cost or the danger being too high. So China's a big chunk of a lot of these metal supply distribution charts, and we don't really have a good handle on what China's going to do. Since 1980, China has been a terrorist in terms of like beating up the markets by producing a lot of this stuff.
I've moved on now, John, to your, so I think it's we that's a great point to make about the security of supply, and here's more on that in the next slide, which the header is security of supply narratives.
Yeah.
So give us an insight into that, John.
So I was kind of charging ahead, but that little chart on the left with the red and the black and the blue and the yellow, that shows you what percent of all these metals comes from these countries. And you can see the world has a pretty high dependency on China. And if you're like a free market globalization ideologue, well, that's no problem. Everybody's going to be rational. Free trade will exist. Self-interest will keep everybody from doing something stupid. But if you don't really believe in that, and you think markets are irrational and people are irrational and countries are irrational, if the world starts getting into tug of wars, and right now with the economic problems that we have, coming up with some sort of war-type conflict has historically always been a way to diffuse domestic pressure. For example, Putin's got a serious problem with oil below $40 a barrel. So he has to go out there and meddle in Syria, meddle everywhere, get the locals all worked up into a nationalistic frenzy so that they stop looking at their own unemployment and the fact that their social services are declining because their commodity-based revenues are in the crapper type of situation. The other point of this chart is, I didn't get into it during this talk, but you look at all these other sub-narratives of security supply, like there's like policy demand drivers, policy supply disruptors, usage innovation, functionality innovation, fashion trends. Going forward, got to look at each metal individually and say, what is it used for? Are there changes coming? Is like the lithium ion battery going to take off? Is what it's used for now going to be eclipsed by brand new demand? How is the supply infrastructure set up to handle this sort of stuff? So I look at the juniors now in terms of these potential scenarios, not just related to geopolitical disruption, but also to policy changes and innovation changes. Like let's say China starts cracking down on its environmental stuff. That would have a major impact on Chinese supply. Probably 10-15% of Chinese supply would disappear, and that would have a huge impact on prices.
Okay, so we got to keep aware of those kind of things. I see the next slide is the elements of power from David Abraham.
Yeah, so this is a new book that just came out, and I'm working on a review of it that goes into more detail. But it's an enjoyable read because it summarizes all the different themes and aspects of the whole sort of critical metals security supply type narratives that nobody ever cared about before 2009. But the rare earth boom really made it manifest that we need to think about this. And because the markets for many of these metals are quite small, the big guys don't really pay attention to them. So there are windows for juniors to look in different parts of the world and come up with a tungsten project or a cobalt project, or even a niobium one to compete with the monster Arasha deposit. And if one of these dislocations happens that are related to security of supply, then you could get an abrupt move in that metal where suddenly everybody is, you get a hot metal, and if you're a junior that's got it, you're going to take off. So the book is a good read.
In all these charts that your logo is in the top, does that mean that investors can also get those, or I mean your subscribers can get those charts as well for the production of all those various different commodities?
Oh, Alan, it's much better than that. Those charts are on a page under research tools called special charts, and this is the metal supply charts. And they're free. It's unrestricted. It's my service to the public. I hope like school children, students, all kinds of people interested for their own purpose. Go and look at these things. I just updated them for all the 2015 numbers, which came out in late January.
That's great, John. So you could say, for example, you felt there was a concern for copper supply and you wanted to go and check out how the production numbers are looking. And that's what somebody can do on your website. And here it is for free. That's awesome, John.
And it's all USGS data. I mean, they put it in PDFs and so on. So I've gone to the trouble to manually import it and compile it and then create these charts. It's actually an extraordinarily underappreciated resource. And right now I'm working going back all the way to 1931. In fact, you can see with molybdenum, I've already done that. And it's fascinating to see countries come and go as major suppliers.
Yeah, they become the dominant color and then they shrink out of it. That's, you know, John, a lot of your work has been over the years about graphically representing these stories. And here's just another perfect example of how you do that. And I noticed in the next chart, you have a whole series of this with high risk of geopolitical train wrecks and unintended consequences. This is a slide 11 of 30, and I think it fits into what you're just talking about there very nicely.
Yeah, I mean, about a decade ago, I realized I was absolutely ignorant about an awful lot of things, like where did they come from and so on. And so I went on a manic accumulation of data and putting them into charts so that I could understand them. And frankly, it's been huge because it's enabled me now, when I read the Financial Times and that, I have a huge sort of a big picture background from just looking at these charts. For example, you look at that oil consumption chart. How many people in the world know that since 1980, American oil consumption has been flat? Even though their economy has grown substantially during that period. In fact, all of the oil demand that we've, consumption growth that we've seen has come from other places. And so you scratch your head and wonder, why is this? And then you start thinking, fuel efficiency.
Exactly.
And what helps with fuel efficiency standards? And are we on the cusp of another fuel efficiency bout? And so on. So,
but then you could learn other things that, you know, you want to use that as an indicator of what's going to happen in the future when you see that, you know, you see that purple one is expanding or the blue one is expanding. The purple one has been on a very strong growth trend. You start to be able to understand things a lot more significantly, John.
And here's another example. If you look at that global crude oil production chart, you'll see that the 13.1% purple slice is the United States. And when I compiled this stuff last June, when BP made its annual energy outlook report available, I nearly fell off the chair, because the story in the past decade has been about how the United States is a perennial net importer of oil because they consume more oil than they produce. All of a sudden, they're in first place. The Saudis were really pissed off about that because it was shale oil that did that. So this war on America that Saudi Arabia has launched by, in fact, not just managing its production, but ramping it up to crush the price, they are trying to destabilize the shale oil revolution in the United States and also do a number on Canada with its oil sand stuff, so that these countries become dependent on Middle Eastern oil supply as they were before. And I'm not sure that sits well upstairs in Washington. And these are other reasons to expect a train wreck in the Middle East that say, you know, Saudi Arabia is a big source of support for all this jihadi extreme Islam. There's also monetary support coming through Saudi channels. And this mess in Syria, well, who knows if it doesn't turn out that ISIS ends up doing a reverse takeover of Saudi Arabia. And when that happens, do you think Saudi Arabia's oil pumps are going to continue loading oil onto tankers? It's suddenly Saudi Arabia offline. I think we're going to have $60 plus oil because that's what America needs for its shale oil industry. It is retrenching right now. I bet the numbers for last year, they are no longer in first place. But the beauty about shale oil, yes, all the money spent, all those companies are going to go bankrupt. The creditors are going to, own their loans. And then as when oil gets back to $60, well, shale oil is CapEx up front, and it produces a very quick payback. So America will be blasting away these horizontal fracking wells again very quickly, and all they need is higher $60 plus oil. And the rest of the world does too.
Looking at this chart, or these various charts, you sure can get a better picture of what's the important stuff that you should be looking at. But I'm scrolling ahead here and I see that the next chart on page slide 12 is gold bug narrative. This is what I want to hear, John. Let's move to the gold bug narrative.
Well, it's no longer fun to beat up on the ideological skulls, with all their Austrian stuff and their righteousness and so on. I mean, those guys have been so wrong.
And their conspiracies. John, I've never been able to figure out if it was a conspiracy to keep gold down in the 90s. Was it a conspiracy? Did the same conspirators decide to drive it up in the 2000s?
The conspiracy is always of a suppression nature, not of an upside manipulation nature. But the point I'm making with these charts here is I use this to explain to people why sort of $1,200 gold really doesn't feel good for the juniors and the even the producers. And the thing I want to point your attention to is that green line, which is basically takes $400 gold in 1980 and inflation adjusts it to the present where it's about $1,160. So, where gold is now, it had this 20-year bear market from 1980 until about 2003 when it finally came out of its gutter. But the reason it was in a bear market was because that gain from $35 was 400% in real terms. And then you look at my supply evolution chart there, how much gold was produced each year. And you see it's like not that much, 45 million ounces in 1980. And then it just ramps up, starts to fade when it sags to 260 because the UK thought it was great to announce it was selling its gold every 2 months or whatever. And, talk about a dumb trading strategy. And then, of course, when it takes off, you can see supply going up again. And, of course, these projections by CPM and them, I don't believe them. I think gold is now maxed out at about 95 million ounces a year. It's not going to keep climbing. But during that period, 2.5 billion new ounces mined and loaded on top of the 3.2 billion that existed in 1980. And gold's price is basically the same as $400, except that $400, all those ounces were low-hanging fruit that's now been harvested.
So all the stuff here, more costly stuff, but you haven't really had any joy in the real price of gold.
Yes, so if the world wants more gold, then, you know, it's going to have to pay a higher price because the mining industry is not going to keep adding 90 million ounces a year at prices that are basically the same as 1980, but the ounces are lower grade and the costs are higher and there's bigger environmental and social license and even taxation costs with it. So that's why I'm kind of bullish that if the world wants a lot more total gold, it's going to have to pay up. And that's where the companies that have ounces in the ground that maybe don't work here, but work at 1500 stand to benefit in a big way.
So next slide, John, I think you're going into more reasons why you think that it just has a series of charts on where interest rates could go. I think that's part of your argument of what could affect gold price.
Well, you know, the point I'm making here is like these predictions about inflation, why have they not come true? Well, the little Fred chart that you see in the lower right is the velocity of M2, which is the rate at which which money changes hands. And that has collapsed as they printed
like
money.
90s.
Yeah, it's at record lows. Some of the charts, yeah, even go even earlier. So it is when the velocity of money increases that you get inflation. All this money printing has gone to parties that aren't like the lower, you know, the 99% in terms of the income distribution, who would go out and spend it. It's gone into these sort of 1% hands.
And hoarders, John.
Yes, and it's made their assets whole again. They had all these assets that were still marked to a fantasy price, and this printing of money has made this whole again. And because they have known about that, this entire monetary easing, quantitative easing, it is basically a fraud that's not going to drive the economy. This is why companies have sat on their cash and either bought back their own shares or distributed as dividends and not invested it. There's an end times mentality in the United States and perhaps even in other old world parts of the world that has kept the kind of expansion of the economy that would generate inflation.
John, do you think there's anything that can change that direction?
At some point, things can change. Now again, that chart on the left there, which is the M2, which is the green bars, and people have said, well, gold has to go up because the money supply has increased so much. Yes, but the value of the money of gold stock has also increased substantially. So that red line is the percentage, and the level that it's at is still above where it's been for much of the past 20 years. So when people say this is all unstable and all that, it actually isn't. There's no special reason for
gold
to go higher.
So you're saying that despite them printing more cash, there's been more value creation in the price of gold. So that's not a fair comparison in a historical sense.
But while the value of the gold, which is considered as an alternative to the money supply itself as a an asset class, has increased substantially. And it's not like it's sitting there suppressed by some conspirators and is going to slingshot to substantially higher levels. The chart I want to point out to people is the red one in the middle, which is the home mortgages held by the total amount, which is the blue line, and the red, which is the increase per quarter. And you can see since about 2008 or so, it completely crashed and has been negative during that whole period. But the U.S. mortgage market
has, to the upside recently, I see there.
Yeah, yes. And so it's been deleveraging since 2008. You do not get real estate prices in the ordinary homes that most Americans own going up dramatically when there isn't a credit expansion enabling people to buy. And the banks haven't wanted to lend because they have a very low interest rates and a very, very poor spread. So they've been very cautious about about whom they lend to. And of course, they've looked at the GDP growth numbers and so on, and they said, you know, there's not a growth track here. You know, we can't grow ourselves out of a debt problem. So there's, again, this end times mentality, America's not really growing, has created a degree of paralysis, which also now underpins the pissed offness of all the people, and why you got people going for Bernie Sanders, who has socialist policies that people supposedly have no interest in, and Donald Trump, who has like no intelligible policies at all, but sits there and swears at people and calls people names and stuff like that.
And pays women off like they're a second-rate citizen, and looks at buddies beside him and waves them off like he's at the schoolyard.
Yeah. So I mean, in my view, like everybody's worried about the interest rates. Tanking everything, but higher interest rates are what banks need in order to start lending. And if they start lending, we will start seeing real estate go up more. That creates a wealth effect that is experienced by ordinary people, 99%ers. The wealth effect makes no difference to 1%ers. They don't have enough time in the day to spend their wealth. So extra wealth for them doesn't really stimulate the economy.
I've moved on to slide 14 now. I think you started to lead into it a little bit. It's the one with Donald Trump on the picture and then the two charts. It's slide 14, John, I'm on now.
Yeah. So one of the things that I did to come up with an alternative model for trying to figure out where gold is going to do is, the gold price doesn't mean anything. For example, like Pierre Lassonde likes to relate the Dow to the price of gold, and there's just no real rational basis for assigning any meaning to that relationship. But the value of the gold stock as a percentage of global GDP in nominal U.S. dollar terms, that is meaningful. And this chart kind of shows how it peaked in 1980, way up there at 25%, crashed all the way to 3.8% in 2001 when gold was 260, and peaked at 14% in 2011 when gold hit the high. And now it's hovering around 8.8%. And what I say is that percentage is actually a measure of anxiety, uncertainty about the future. And if you can predict what that level will be, that will tell you what the value of the gold stock will be relative to the economy. And one of the arguments I've made is that much of the future growth in the world is coming from emerging market economies such as China, which results in America having a relatively smaller percentage of GDP, which over time will limit its ability to project power as the single superpower and as the biggest economy. And that makes the world much more unstable in the long run. So I've argued that prosperity growth in the world is the key to higher real prices, because it's going to unleash a anxiety level of, let's say, 10%. And if you predict whatever the additional gold that gets added and then project that, you see that red line there? Yeah. You know, by 2018, that 10% gold should be at $1,400-$1,500. And that has nothing to do with inflation. Now, from the geopolitical instability type of thing, if you look at the pink line where it soars to 3,224, that's actually the gold stock as 25% of GDP. And that's what happened in 1980 when everybody thought America was losing it. OPEC was out of control, the Tehran hostage crisis, they sent in their helicopters and they all crashed and burned in the sand, and it was a humiliation. It came in the wake of the Vietnam disaster, and it looked like America was done. And there you get that kind of anxiety. And what we're seeing now is we're not seeing the prosperity growth, but we are seeing the growth of idiocy, where guys like Trump, with the nonsense that he spews out, is now the contender to be the presidential nominee for the Republican Party. And given this the wonky mood everybody is going in, if he ends up going against Hillary, it's possible he could actually be the next president. And I tell you, if that happens, even I would want to own a bunch of gold.
You might have to move back home, John.
Yeah. Move back to Canada, except we'll probably get invaded.
For all our water and energy. Okay, so John, now you've made a good case there now for gold and how to rationally look at it. Your next slide, I think, starts to get into now, say I am bullish on gold. You know, how do I look at the discovery exploration, finding a deposit that is feasible, prevailing prices? I think you're starting to put things together here for me, John.
Yeah. So what I'm actually really saying with the discovery exploration narrative is that if you're not super bullish about gold, look for exploration companies that have a strategy to find a gold deposit that works at 1250 gold or 1150 gold, that's got such a high grade and such a large size that it's going to be put into production at these prices, which are in essence what the price was in 1980 when gold was $400. And so here I talk
now
about...
Now you're saying regardless of what happens with the price of gold, if they keep doing what they do and they get a reasonable valuation for that, you should see a good return on your investment.
Yeah, I mean, there's two groups of companies out there, those that are looking for a gold deposit and those that have a gold deposit. And the ones that have good gold deposits don't exist anymore because they've been acquired by the bigger companies. And the ones that have deposits that don't really work at the present, they're called optionalities, options on a higher gold price. So if gold goes to $1,600, which is a 20% increase, that $300-$400 is a huge difference to the discounted cash flow model, to the NPV of the company. So a company that the market's now pricing as, even less than the amount of money they spent demonstrating the non-feasibility of the project, these valuations can increase 4, 5, 10 times in the event of such a move in gold. So that's what a lot of people have been hoping on. They've been accumulating these ounce in the ground projects. But because gold has been relatively slow getting its act together, these companies end up getting bought out at 100% premiums. I mean, look at pure true gold. Just got bought out at 50 cents or so by Endeavor, which undertook a 10-for-1 rollback. Then with only 40 million shares out, they cranked up the stock, doubled it to $12, and now are issuing their ramped up currency paper as currency to acquire True Gold. And all those people, they're all happy. They're inside a bigger company. They get liquidity. This is creating liquidity events. There's not a lot of things they can recycle themselves into. That pool of optionalities is diminishing. And that's why I'm saying, look at the three ways you can make money through exploration.
Okay, John. I noticed you had probe mines up there. Was that? Did you have probe mines up there for a particular reason?
Yes. There is a special reason. There's three ways you can make a significant discovery. One is by applying new exploration methods, and I think in an earlier session we talked about like Uravanza radiogenic lead isotope chemical method.
Or the Nevada.
Nevada explorations, gold and groundwater. So you end up seeing targets that nobody has ever seen, and some of them could be absolute monster, basically undercover targets. Then there's traditional grassroots exploration, such as what Cerios has been doing in central Quebec in the Eleanor area, where they get the prospectors out there, they do the geochem surveys, the geophysics, and they gradually home in. And that's sort of come out of favor because it's tough for this type of exploration to deliver targets that haven't already been found, ones that are readily visible at the surface. The third group is the one that is most interesting. And the original example is Robert Friedland's Oyu Tolgoi, which he acquired from BHP back in 2003 for money that people thought was way too much. And what he got was, and you see in a little chart there, the greenish open pitable stuff, and BHP got a good deal at the time. Except Robert put his geos to work to like rethink this whole thing, and they come up with the Hugo Dummett zone. Much bigger, with multiples of the copper gold grade and now a world-class underground block caving mine. So this is an example of you did a bunch of work, you got something that doesn't work at the metal prices that you have, but have you really accounted for the metal budget implied by the scale of the alteration system, its footprint, and all that? And if you can come up with a scientific argument that there is metal missing and a case as to where it might have ended up, then people will give you money and you could come up with a Hugo Dumitzel. And Probe is a more recent example because they did a great grassroots discovery with the Borden zone, the disseminated zone, 1 gram, 5 million ounces. But by the time they had that delineated, gold had crashed to $1,200, $1,300. And that had become, like, once again, a geochemical anomaly and was no longer a mine. And they never did do a PEA. But they kept on following the system, see where it goes, and they got into the high-grade stuff, which is underground mineable, a different style of mineralization, though still related to the system. And they got a $500 million buyout from Goldcorp. So a lot of these...
It's a bad market too, John.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, it was frustrating for us because what we thought would turn into a much bigger play got taken offline by Goldcorp way too soon. And I guess we'll find out in a year or two whether or not when they chase this thing down plunge, if it does indeed blossom and turn into another Red Lake type thing, in which case that $500 million will have been a pittance to have sold the company for.
Now that we've got gold going in the right way again and hopefully more interest in exploration, I think your next slide is really a good tool, elements of a good exploration story in the new reality.
Yeah,
so and that's slide 16.
So I did not actually spend any time during my presentation on this because, you know, again, this slide could take forever. But when you have these existing systems, these deposits that don't fly at the current metal price, these companies should be going back and thinking, have we accounted for all the possible gold? And turning what is an optionality into a dual play, one where you have you're doing exploration within it. And I think even if gold stalls, there is now an appetite for exploration. And people say, well, it's just a matter of time before gold goes up properly, but we don't want to sit here and be swallowed up by some of these other companies, these bigger companies, and have our optionality scavenged by those guys. So tell us what you got here. Can you find something like Probe did, like Ivanhoe did with Oyu Tolgoi? And these are all the kinds of questions that management should be asking themselves, and investors should be asking management, have you asked these, and what are the answers? And if the answers are, this is all we have, okay, fine. Well, maybe we'll get a double out of you when you get taken out.
You know, John, I think two of these questions that I really think it's important for investors not just to ask these questions, but to listen to the tone and the way that people respond. You can learn a great deal about what someone's concerned about and what they're excited about just by asking a couple of these questions. You know, I think this business has a way of having a lot of narcissists in it, John, and they don't like to be asked those tough questions. And I think you'll learn a lot by not just asking these questions, but listening to what they have to say and how they're saying it.
And you know, one of my bottom fish, Clifton Star, they had a lot of money. They're trading at 15 cents. Cash breakup was 25 cents. And their VP of exploration, Louis Martin, had taken the Duquesne project and digitized all the existing data and then you know, viewed it from all these perspectives and realized, oh my gosh, here are plunge controls that project into areas where no drill hole has ever tested it. This crappy 500,000 ounce resource, which is at best a, you know, mill feed for somebody else, could be part of a 1 to 2 million ounce system. So he put together a whole plan that would cost 1 to 2 million bucks to go in there and test the down plunge and also a long strike, test for theoretical repeats of these plunges that had not ever been tested. So he came up with a whole concept and exploration model, and it was kind of a bummer that the First Mining Finance acquired them for about 40 cents worth of paper. And at first I thought, these guys are just raiding the treasury of whatever, 13, 14 million bucks. But last week they acquired the Pitt project, which is next door, which is part of this story. So again, some of these bigger guys aren't just buying optionalities. They're also buying these plays where you can go in there and start doing something to enhance the existing resource, which seems worthless until the metal price goes higher.
You know, John, I can really get a sense in your tone and in the tone of people and how people are listening to stories again. It sort of feels like a renaissance of exploration again that I really haven't felt even in the run-up. You know, in the run-up in the 2001 to 2011 for the price of gold, it doesn't feel quite like this. This feels more like in the 90s when I remember more vibrant exploration stories all over. Are you sensing that as well, John?
Yes, yes. And I've been predicting that this is the natural evolution, and I'm thrilled that I'm now actually seeing evidence of my predictions. And I give you an example. Like in the 80s and 90s when we had discovery exploration markets, that was pre-internet age. And everybody, you know, if you went to a conference, you got a physical handout or something like that. But when you look at the graphics that are now available on company websites and PowerPoint presentations, the ability of companies to take the digital data and show it and explain to people, to lure the investors or potential investors into understanding, here is what we believe we are going to find, and here's why, and here's what we need to make or break this. This is a whole new dynamic that was not available to an open-ended audience. It was available to like the brokers and a few of the rounders in Vancouver and all that, because it was not a digitized internet world. And the last decade was not about this stuff. This is the first time that we're going to see total focus using all these tools to show the public, here's what we think is happening and what we can do about it.
And I think your next slide is a perfect example of something that we wouldn't have thought about in the past, but now are able to use some new science on things, is groundwater chemistry, the key to finding new Nevada's missing gold. Maybe it is or maybe it isn't, but it is something to look at, to try to research. And I can see you've done that here with a group of slides, John.
Yeah, and the point of this slide is, in the old days, people say, yeah, you got a target. Okay, tell me when you have a gold intersection, and then what? And then we'll get a momentum trade going, and we'll get the phone room going, and we'll get a big pump going, and we'll blow off our paper, and then you guys keep drilling, and maybe you'll accidentally, through grid drilling, actually outline something. But now there's a desire to understand the geology, the genesis. How did this region come about? Why is there so much gold in this region? Or why is there just smoke and no major deposits? Is there potential for Carlin-type deposits? And when you think back until the late 60s, early 70s, when they started following the low-grade stuff at surface and hitting into the very deep stuff, this whole sort of northern Nevada was a pitiful gold thing. Now it is known as one of the richest gold parts of the world. You know, over 300 million ounces have been identified, and these are not low-grade ounces, and that's probably only half of what's available. The other half is hidden under those basins type of thing. So what companies need to do is also become geology 101 instructors, teach their audiences, you know, how do these vein systems work, what are the driving factors, why do we think, say, in Sirius, why do we think that when we drill through this and get into the metasediments, the stuff should start blossoming because it's a, you know, because it's a better sponge. It soaks up and holds the gold more. All this kind of geology is, and it's so easy now to teach the public. You don't have to go to evening classes like we used to have to do in the 80s in Vancouver to have some sort of remote understanding of basic geology.
Look at the charts you've put up there, John. You can understand subduction. You can understand geochem. You can see the models. I mean, these tools, like you said, were very... I remember when we were in the 90s and we used to get these plastic see-through trays and we would put a series of these on sections, and that was how we did our sections, was on a piece of plexiglass, and then we looked at, and then that's how we modeled things. We thought we were pretty ingenious back then.
Yeah, I'm just looking for my little box that I still have from 1983 of all my little specimens that the Chamber of Mines in Vancouver used to give to us when we pay our $20 for this, and then we would be supposed to take that box with us to the core boxes at a conference and
go find out how to find stuff. Your next slide, John, has got me interested. Is Chichu the next Eleanor discovery in Central Quebec? This is the serious one you've been talking about earlier, right?
Yeah, and we talked about it earlier a fair bit.
And on our show.
Yes, and we broke the story, you know, in an earlier show, and this thing is gaining traction. And if you look, you see that area, mystery potential, that I've got marked in that one graphic? That was in the thing that I put out a few weeks ago or mid-February. Where I put together the story. This comment will probably be, recommendation strategy will probably become a classic because it explained. I know one of my subscribers went out and bought 1 million shares on the basis of that thing.
Wow.
And he is absolutely pleased that Dominique Doucette went in there and drilled 10 holes and several of them close to the margin have confirmed that the same sort of mineralization as in that southeast corner is now present in that hatched area, which is all overburden covered. And they'll probably drill a lot more holes there before the thaw because you can't really get in there during the summer because it's a swamp. So they'll get a bunch of holes there and it won't be enough, you know, because they won't even get assays until they have to pull out. They won't be able to return until 2017. They will then go back to the area where they can work, probably raise another few million dollars here, just in case, you know, gold does decide to go into the dumper and we have the PDAC curse say, I'm still here. And these guys have the money to keep beavering away and sorting out the high-grade structures. And another thing about the point I was making about here, you see in the bottom left chart, you see all the holes sort of pointing in the southwest direction.
Yep.
Well, there is a control along the sort of margin between that yellow stuff and the blue stuff, which where the mineralization came up, and they thought they would, you know, drill across the control. But they're now starting to realize that there may be controls within the control that are northeast southwest. So they've started drilling holes in a northwest direction in the hope that they will get intersections that they then can plot up in a section and say, hey, here's a high-grade structure, a zone that could actually be developed as a potential underground mine, and now let's start following it and see where it goes. And this is the big thing we're waiting for right now is the results of this program to see if they have been drilling it in the wrong direction, and that if they go in there with a major program this summer, they're going to end up delineating the high-grade zones that are needed to make this big low-grade system a source of a future mill feed for Eleanor.
You know, John, as you were talking about that and I was looking at these various different maps, one thing that really stood out to me was that, you know, now with all these tools, you're able to walk this story out there much differently than 15, 20 years ago, 10 years ago. You can sort of hold the hands of investors and walk them through this exploration cycle. I'm doing the same thing with this new Red Lake, this RLG on the Canadian securities. I'm kind of taking them under my wing and following them closely because there again, it's an interesting story where you've got this east-west structure that leads to the Red Lake mines and they have a cross-cutting structure that's never been drilled before yet. The structures that had been drilled, where it had been drilled other than this big hinge zone where the structures intersect, had never been drilled. But this on the structures had been drilled, and they've hit a lot of gold, but they've never looked for the pocket where the best stuff is. And so I'm now helping the audience sort of walk how they're doing their drilling. They're using the structures to lead them to the hinge zone. And once they get to the hinge zone, then they're going to use that hinge zone to go to depth to chase the goal. So now the audience that's following that story is much more informed, just like you're informing people with this SOI and all this work. I'm really optimistic how that's going to change the market for the future.
Yeah, no, I agree. And one of the things you're pointing out is there's different scales at which this can be done. What you're describing is even a more smaller detailed scale, but you're talking about very high grade. Here we're hoping to find three to eight gold over bigger widths as opposed to, 50, 100 gram gold over 1-2.
You're looking for a high grade, low grade there. You're looking for a low grade that actually is pretty high for an open pit mining area. Correct?
Yeah. And one thing before we move on, look at the top central chart, which I got from Azimuth, and it shows sort of comparative scale of on the left and on the right, that the geochemical footprints for Eleanor on the left and for the Chichu area. And of course, they don't have the data for the Sirios ground, but if you look at that sort of hatched line, that's their interpretation of the outline of this tonalite body. And their drilling was all done in the northwest corner on some metasediment stuff that didn't have any running room. And they drilled one hole off in the east and a couple farther east and didn't get anything super interesting. But it's quite possible that whatever it is that sits underneath this system has not been tested at all by these guys. And that's why I sort of have this teaser in there. Is this going to be like a Hemlo story where you got one company chasing all this smoke on its ground and it starts getting something? It turns out to be part of a giant high grade, 20 million ounce system that extends onto the adjoining property. And if we get something like that going, well, then East Main will have to start pouring money into this. The little Azimuth takes off, and Goldcorp will become very aggressive because they already own.
You just laid out the possibility of an area play and gave all the players before it's even happened.
Yeah, and look at the map on the north and in the far upper left corner. That's sort of a regional map. And when this whole... When Eleanor was discovered, it was a huge regional area play, and everybody looked for the easy pickings. Nothing was found. We got bummed out and said, okay, Eleanor's a freak, a great, 8 to 12 million ounce medium to high grade deposit, but there's nothing else in here. If this Sirios thing, which and the tonalite zone wasn't found till 2011, so like 6-7 years, after Eleanor was discovered, if it turns out that this is another major gold mineralizing event that ends up having 10 million plus ounces, the entire region has to be revisited. What was found to be an inadequate surface showing now will need to be rethought. So if this thing really blossoms, we revitalize this area and we might end up having a district of multiple gold systems, not just a freak. The sad thing about Hemlo is it was a freak. Nothing else, even remotely comparable, was found in the vicinity.
If you got a new area hot play like that in gold in Quebec, that's really exciting, John. You've got another, I'm going to kind of keep moving on. And just for an update, John, we've gone way over, our time here. We're at slide... I think 19 or close to 20. We've got a few more to go through, but you know what, John? People can hit pause and come back later. They're getting a phenomenal amount of
good. I have a better suggestion. Let's break it up into like a bunch of parts. I mean, that's what BNN has done with my market call thing. It's a pain in the ass because I got to come up with the links for each of the segments, but you could break this into whatever half hour segments. Because I myself wouldn't want to digest myself for 2 hours.
Well, we'll blast through them, John, and then we'll figure it out later. So your next one is Hermosa Taylor, the biggest American. Oh, this is the, AZ.
Yes, the one we talked about.
You
scooped me on all these things.
Sorry, John, but I think it's all good for your subscribers that jumped on board of it, too.
Yeah, so I mean here again is kind of like a storyboard showing stuff. It's in Arizona. They spent $40 million doing a pre-feasibility study on an oxide zone that was open pittable, that was going to produce silver, electrolytic manganese, and some zinc. It had a nasty, complicated flow sheet. By the time they published it at the end of 2013, metal prices were headed into the tank, and it was one of those optionalities. But Don Taylor, who had come in the late stages of that feasibility demonstration cycle, he started looking at the sulfides at the base of the pit that weren't going to be part of the flow sheet, and just started following it with drill holes. And lo and behold, he finds streaking off, plunging towards the northwest, an enormous high-grade zinc, lead, silver, carbonate replacement sulfide system. And they did further homework, and there's that big hole step out that you see in the lower left chart. That was a hole drilled decades ago by a Sarco on adjoining ground. They owned that big green claim, and they were mining some lead silver leakage vein mineralization in the volcanics that sit on top of the limestone. The sulfide deposit actually sits at the interface, which you can see in the bottom right type of a chart. And there you can see the cartoon they've done. They show all the data that they do have. They have the big question mark in the middle. You know, who knows, the geology could have like dropped it all down big, so it's never a sure thing until you drill it. But the geological context here is that if they start walking the drills across this entire property, they are going to find more and more of the stuff, especially since at 1,600 meters depth, you still have the same sort of high grade and widths. So this will be a 200 million ton high grade lead, zinc, silver system within which they're looking for 50 million tons that they can mine at whatever 7,000 tons per day as an underground mine. And then this thing will operate for many, many decades after the initial mine life. And you can see the original resource, that's a clip from the profile. I input these things, and again, these are all the tools that people have available. And that other thing, the after-tax sensitivity, that is that thing modeled at the numbers in their PFS, which of course shows that at present prices, the thing is hideously, hideously uneconomic.
You know, it sure has woken up recently, John, and I saw the 20% deal. I used the tool to go and do some homework. You know, you showed me how to find the people that were involved with it in the past, and that the guys that had sold the company already down there and did very well, real experienced in Arizona. So yeah, I'm good on you, John. That's been a great one. I hope some of the viewers listen to that. Moving on to your next slide here, John, I'm at this deposit valuation focuses on future cash flow from a depleting asset. A mine is an annuity.
Yes, so this is the discounted cash flow model. And basically, it is the revenues minus the costs and taxes, and that's your cash flow. And in, for each of the years of the mine until the mine's depleted, and the 20th year of cash flow is worth less than the first year, and there's a nasty little formula that I've got there. It exists in spreadsheets and all that kind of stuff. It is the valuation basis for all deposits. This is what everybody uses to figure out what it's worth and what they should pay for it now.
So now that is crucial in the next series of slides, which are your introducing KRO outcome visualizations, and then I see you've got a few slides there of how they fit into various things, which leads you to the Arizona mining. So why don't you quickly run through those three or four slides, John, and then put it in the context of the slide for Arizona, because that's the one that really stands out to me.
So when we were looking at slide 20, it all looked pretty and all that, and you could see, okay, 40 million tons of whatever, and you could see, well, that's worth whatever, six billion or so in situ. But what is it worth in economic terms? And so what I've started doing is visualizing, imagining a plausible mine. And of course, I do this even earlier with projects where we don't have a resource estimate. I imagine what sort of deposit is possible here, one that actually has a good value. What sort of costs would be associated with mining it? And I come up with all these numbers, push a button, all the little equations and that get run by the computer. It comes up with the after-tax NPV and IRR, and you can see that on slide 21. And what I do now is I share this with my my subscribers as part of my argument as to why I think this stock will ultimately be worth $5. So if we skip to slide 21, there you can see all the grade assumptions that are made. In this case, I've just taken the grades from the actual 43101, and then you see weird words like recovery and payable, concentrate grade, and all that sort of stuff.
So you're taking everything into consideration, I see, in the next few slides, and that goes into how you project the one for Arizona mining and your rational speculation, right, John?
Yes, and there's the cost page too, and you can see all the cost assumptions. And what I do is I show all my
grade recovery, the payable, the various different, all the variables that go into it. I can see all that, John.
And you know, I do my best guess, and I've already gotten feedback from people that some of these numbers are way too conservative, yeah. Like the 600,000, 100 million capex and 300 million sustaining capital, way too high for this scale of project. So I'm going to go back in there and put in new numbers and redo this and resubmit it and see what happens. Now, and I also have a way of creating my own. If you go to slide 25, you'll see a bunch of risk factors, and I have a way of constructing the discount rate, because you know that the smaller your discount rate, the bigger your NPV number, and gold companies love to use 5%, which is like total BS to use 5% as your discount rate. You know, when interest rates finally go up, they're not going to be able to use that. But what you should use is a risk-adjusted discount rate. And so I've created a way of forcing myself to break down, to look at all the risk factors and think, where could this screw up? Is it going to be a permitting problem? In this case, well, yeah, it's in America, and there's a whole army of anti-mining people who are going to be jumping up and down and saying, bad, 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 no good mine in America. Go have mine in China. Let those people eat the dirt downstream. Yeah, let's call get our folks on the smartphone that comes from all that stuff from China and that, and let's keep America pure and clean and just let the other people overseas suffer. Anyways, so that's going to be an issue. So I got a high risk there. Social license, you know, there's no Aboriginal groups in this area. There might be some retiree communities nearby. Not a very high risk. Title, again, in some parts of the world or where there's been a chain of interesting transactions leading to ownership, that can be a problem. Tax is not really a big problem in the United States because they already have high taxes. In other jurisdictions, there's a risk of windfall taxes or crazy royalties. Geopolitical risk, some places, yes. In America, not so much. Infrastructure, well, are you really remote and you need a big pipeline or electricity grid built that you don't completely control? Technical, this is going to become more and more important because as we look at projects with more complex metallurgy, to up decent grades but more metallurgy, there's always the risk that the flow sheet doesn't work. And then, of course, there's the management risk. In this case here, we got Jim Gowans as the CEO. He built Polaris. He built Red Dock. He's been CEO of De Beers Canada. You have like a top-notch experienced person in charge of this. And it turns out he is quite pumped. He was appointed late last year, and he sees that this as his next major zinc, lead, silver development play. So
you, I can see, John, that you've taken all the crucial economic variables, all the risk factors, and now this leads us to slide 26, right? Now,
yes.
Tell the audience how that all, what that represents.
Now, this is what you were referring to as the elegant system that I have created.
Yes. And
you can see there's a 9 rows going from grassroots to production. And you see these little figures, 0.5% to 1%. And I call this the uncertainty range, which actually means that whatever you think is going to come out with this, it's like got 99 to 99.5% uncertainty with it. And in gambling theory, if you think something's going to end up worth $100 million and you have 99% uncertainty about it, well, the value of that outcome is like 1%. So in other words, $1 million. So if you can say that your project's potentially worth $100 million, it should be valued at $1 million from $500,000 to $1 million. So you can see that the ranges change. I convert them to Canadian dollars. And then I also convert them to price ranges. And the price ranges is what really everybody cares about. And this project's now at sort of, infill drilling PEA. I've tagged it as PEA because that's their goal, deliver that by the end of the year. And if my outcome is correct of $1 billion US NPV, right now it should command a valuation of about 100 million, or let's say for in Canadian dollars, 134 million. To 335 million. That's fair speculative value range, 57 cents to $1.43. And looking at that table of numbers,
based on this stage of where they are at, right?
Yes.
Okay. So based on this stage of where they at, and based on comparing all the various different variables, it makes a case that even at this valuation, they're undervalued.
That's right. So, but of course, the brain doesn't really want to juggle numbers. So that graphic that you have up there, I call it an implied value chart. You've got on the left column a log scale of the outcome or of the value, and then on the bottom you have the stage, and the little star is how the market is pricing this project right now, which is whatever 235 million shares times 46 cents divided by 100%, in other words, 1, and that gives you your 100% normalized valuation for the project. And the blue is actually that the Canadian dollar fair speculative value range plotted as a graphic. So rather than sit there and compare the actual implied value to whatever little thing, I just look at this chart and I can tell right away, if I believe that $1.3 billion outcome is plausible based on everything that's been generated to date, this stock needs to be bought until it's parked inside that blue channel.
I get it. And you can also, I could go and say, I could take a company, let's say I'm apples to apples comparison, but they're two stages back. Okay. Mm-hmm. I could go and say, well, actually, this company is overvalued relative. If they're on the same track, why would I buy the overvalued one? But in the past, how am I going to compare two companies like that and say, well, this is overvalued and this one isn't?
Yeah, exactly. And that's how I have these relative spec value versus absolute spec value. Absolute spec value is when the thing, based on the numbers that have been published, the market is underpricing it. Relative spec value, I apply, use either when there are no numbers yet that are published that I can use, or they are published, but everything's overpriced and I don't want to quit and not play. So when you get into a bull market, everything is overpriced. What we are experiencing right now is extremely anomalous that we actually
all those dots in the bull market would be above the line, that purple line. In a bull market, they'd all be way above that purple line.
Yeah, but you know why it would be above that purple line in a gold market? Because the gold price may be $1,250 now, and that's the number used in there to generate the revenues, which then become the basis for the cash flow. But when gold's at $1,300, everybody thinks that it's going to go to $2,000. So you input $2,000 into the model, and instead of, like, say, a $1.3 billion outcome, you're up there at a $2-3 billion outcome. In other words, that blue channel that you see there should be floating higher. and it is in the minds of the public.
Yeah.
So the spot price anchors it where it is now, but people can also make bets that, hey, gold's going, you put in like Pierre Lassonde's $8,000 number in some of these gold things, and I'm going to have to add 100 billion to my log scale there on the right to accommodate the valuations that will create.
Well, you know, John, when I said it's elegant, I hope that more people try to understand this. And if you're in my audience, subscribe, because this is a kind of tool that I think is extremely useful. Before we close off, John, it looks like your next talking point and your final one was scandium. You got a couple charts on that. Why don't we deal with those, and then we can wrap things up?
Yeah, I mean, this again is like a storyboard of the whole scandium story. I think everybody who's listened to me before knows about it. It's a metal which has never had more than byproducts.
I think that a lot of people have heard the scandium story from your work, and when Robert Friedland got involved as well. But I would say that I don't think the audience understands quite as much as I can certainly say for myself. When you talked about this to me on the show, I came away with a much different understanding
than what I thought I was giving you.
No, I didn't just think of it as another commodity play story of the month or week. And I got a better understanding of the long-term big picture story of what really is going to make scandium work over the long haul, and how tight your story, SCY, is in that big picture.
Yeah. Okay, well I'll give it a quick shot.
Sure.
I would draw people's attention, and we're on slide 28, to the niobium production chart on the right side. And you go way back to where there's almost nothing there, like in the 50s. And that was the reality for niobium back then. People knew, the scientists had already figured out, niobium added as low as 0.01% to iron makes steel that acquires corrosion resistance and is much stronger. But you couldn't really do much with it because the niobium was all byproduct from alluvial mines in Nigeria, in Congo and Rwanda, all these unstable things where if you wanted a lot of niobium, tough luck, you couldn't get it. You couldn't get it even if the price went to the moon. But then you see that that purple shows up in the 60s, and that's the realization that the Araxá phosphate system in Brazil was 500 million tons of 2.5% niobium, which was about 8 to 10 times any sort of bedrock sources that people knew about. And so the Brazilian family, through CBMM, they developed this mine and gradually introduced the steel industry to niobium. And this is now a $2.5 billion a year market. Scandium is in the 1950s portion of that chart. 10-15 tons of byproduct supply from in-situ uranium leaching from the BioNoble rare earth mine, some titanium dioxide waste stripping operations, not scalable at all. But scandium does to aluminum, and even more and better ways, what niobium does to steel. It makes it stronger, it makes it corrosion resistant, it makes it weldable in a way that the welds are as strong as the material itself. And there's enormous latent applications for this, especially in an energy conscious world where the lighter you make stuff that has to be moved, the more energy you save. And the big thing that this story is all about is the discovery by Friedland through his clean tech and Scandium International with their Ningen deposit. New deposits in New South Wales of Australia that are 400 ppm scandium, which is more than 10 times background level and more than three to four times the Softy Vody mine in the Ukraine that the Russians or Soviets mined at 100 ppm and built their MiG fighter jets out of that, like, totally perplexed the Americans, who had to develop titanium-based technology to be able to do top dog fights with the Soviets. So this story is now unfolding. We have a PEA. You can see my little chart in there where I've done the sensitivity at different prices, a definitive feasibility study in a couple of weeks, environmental impact statement, hopefully a mining license by the fourth quarter, then financing, construction in 2017, production in 2018. And then, of course, the big question, if you quadruple the supply of scandium, will there be buyers at $2,000 per kilo?
That's what set it apart for me, John. I thought that this was just another sort of rare earth element kind of a thing, and that, you know, as soon as someone starts producing a bunch, that they would kill the market because it's such a small market, right? But then you made me understand that, no, this is a case where the end users can't get a secure enough supply. And if they could, they would take whatever they could.
Yeah, and the automotive industry, the aircraft industry, they are obvious future off-takers. However, they need to plan, they need to engineer, they need to tool up for it. They are not going to consider this until this pilot plant study has demonstrated that they can produce their 35, 40 tons a year and sell it at 2,000 and still make a profit and have incentive to expand capacity. And
oh, did I lose you, John? Uh-oh. I seem to have lost John there for a second. I'm hoping that he'll come back on, but you know, John has really done a phenomenal job to give me a better understanding of Scandium International, this whole Scandium story. I am following it much more closely, and now I've got up on the screen, you can see the Scandium International Mining Corp stock chart, and John says that there may never be such an obvious winner anybody can easily buy. I got John on. Hey, John.
Everything rebooted and the computer sucked up.
No worries, John. I just talked people through your chart on the Scandium International and the stock chart and your comment. So I want to get you to comment on this before we close it off. You say that there may never be such an obvious winner anybody can easily buy. Won't you make that pitch, and then I'm going to close things off, John.
But how do I do that?
Just tell us why you think that this is going to be the... This could be...
On the phone.
Yeah, right now.
Yeah, okay. So the DFS will tell us how close the numbers are to the PEA numbers, and they suggest that this thing was worth, $200 million Canadian NPV with a capex of whatever, $70 million. And that suggests the thing should be, ultimately worth 80 cents to a buck. However, the real story is, if this works, all these gorillas on the sidelines are going to want a lot. They're going to want 100 tons of this stuff. And they can scale this to 150 tons, so increased production fourfold. So this company is ultimately probably worth 500, 600 million, and the expansion will be funded from the cash flow from the pilot plant study, as I call it. And as for the question, well, who's going to buy this stuff? Well, the critical guys aren't, because they're not going to do it in advance. But take, say, Apple with its iPhone case. A scandium aluminum case is the ideal, perfect material for an iPhone. Certain beer cans, specialized beer cans, made from aluminum scandium, you can have all kinds of weird shapes in that. You take some InBev favorite beer, and you create an elite sort of fancy shape and all that stuff. If the stuff doesn't work or whatever, so they discontinue this special edition line. So these are like no-risk off-takers who are the wings who will soak up this initial supply. And the companies don't want to do any off-take deal until the project's more advanced. But I'm pretty confident the scanner will fly out of the door like hotcakes when it's available. And then the big guys will come to the table and say, can you guarantee us 50 tons a year for the next 10 years? And that's why I think this story, you don't need to drill a discovery hole. You don't need for the price to go up. You simply need delivery of the technical execution of the business plan for this thing to be a huge success.
Perfect, John. That's a great note to end it on, John. You know, you've been very generous with your time today. I didn't want to stop it because I think that we went through so much great stuff. People can always hit pause and go back to it later. I'll do some work to kind of chop it up for people. But thanks again for coming on for such a good show, John.
Yeah, it was a great show. Obviously, even 1 hour wasn't enough.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we'll get you on again soon, John. Thanks a lot, man.
Yeah. Okay, take care. Okay. Let me know when you have the links available.
Yeah, I'm just going to close things off, John. Have a great day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
So, folks, on that note, John was very generous with his time. I think he did, he's one of the top analysts out there. What else can I say? He does his homework. He does great work. He does these tools that he gives out for free. He's got tools that you can pay for. I think you've got to check out John's work. I want to thank my sponsors. This show wouldn't be possible without my sponsors and you, the viewers. Thank you very much. Have a great day. We'll talk to you soon.